Yes, thank you.
You know, we've already heard about our speakers. I'll say a couple of lines from here, then take my seat there and conduct the session. The subject given is business of sports. You've just had lunch, so I was given the very difficult task of getting you awake. You go to Lord's. Several of you have been there. You go to Lord's. There's a very nice museum, a very nice museum. 64% people visiting the Lord's Museum in the last couple of years have been Indians, 64%. And 52%, rather 92% of the 64 say one thing. You know, the first they step in, they meet the stewards and they say, where did Saurav Ganguly open his shirt? That generates enormous revenue for the Lord's Museum. So Saurav, he doesn't get royalty from them. Maybe he should ask now as an MCC member. But just to set it up.
Boria, quickly I'll interrupt. I'm on the MCC World Cricket Committee. And the first thing I said when I went on the first day of the meeting at Lord's, I said I've got two test match hundreds at Lord's. So can you put that up properly so that people ask about the hundreds
Correct.
And not about the shirt?
And, okay. Second point about Saurav, 306 rupees was what C.K. Naidu's bank balance was in 1932. I have his Allahabad bank passbook. Do not ask Saurav Ganguly's bank balance. That tells you about cricket and the transformation in the last 70 years. More importantly, the man who taught us to win abroad, the man who gave Indian cricket teeth and muscle when that did not exist at the turn of the millennium. Ladies and gentlemen, presenting to you one of India's best captains, to me, the best captain, Saurav Ganguly. 2008, 92 years of competition. India for the first time participated in the Olympic Games in 1912. And we keep hearing the same story. How many gold medals has your country won in individual events? Zero. 7:45 a.m., the bespectacled man from Punjab shoots a 10.8 in his final shot, and that holy grail is ours. Unfortunately, he still sits alone at the top of that podium because nobody has been able to match that feat. 1.3 billion Indians, one Abhinav Bindra, ladies and gentlemen, presenting Abhinav Bindra. 1999. Deepa Malik, the tumors resurface. The doctors tell her that you've got to go in for an operation. As is our society, unfortunately, the lack of sensitivity, and three things were told to her. One, you will not be a good mother. Answer to that, she has two daughters, one doing an MBA, one doing a PhD in disability studies at the University of Loughborough. Two, you will never drive a car. She has driven in the most difficult of car rallies around the country. Three, and most important, you will never, ever participate for India, forget your whatever, in an international athletic competition. What does Deepa Malik do? 4.61 meters with the shot put in Rio. Silver medal for the first ever time for India, rewriting the record books. Ladies and gentlemen, Deepa Malik. Saurav, Mr. Singhania just introduced saying we watch cricket and it's the most popular sport. Both of us know in the Ranji Trophy there are 2 crows and 3 donkeys along with you and me maybe watching. We only watch IPL. Will you agree that we love spectacles and not sport?
I think it's the format. It's also the format which brings in people. When I started playing Ranji Trophy, there was no IPL, there was no T20. So people came to watch Ranji Trophy. My first final in 1991, and I'm not that old. It's in the year 1991 and we had about 20,000 people watching a Ranji Trophy final. Bengal played Delhi. So times have changed. People want fast things. People don't have so much time to sit and watch 5-day test cricket. Otherwise, what could be the reason? If I, someone who has played the game, I would be watching Virat Kohli get the 245 in Mumbai rather than him hitting 4 sixes in 4 overs in an IPL game, because that's more quality, that's more... That requires a lot of hard work, a lot of concentration, batting for 2 days. But that's the way the world has gone. It's the acceptance of different formats, and that's the way IPL is so popular. Rather, T20 format is so popular. It's not just IPL. When India plays T20, every seat is full. We hosted the World Cup at Eden Gardens, the Pakistan game. I was thinking where I can print 1,000 more tickets to give to people. So it's the format which people like. And that's the way it is. Certain sport embraces certain countries. You know, you go to England, it's about football. You come to India, it's about cricket. You know, you go to the European countries, it's about football. So that's the way the world works, and you have to live with it.
Abhinav, you know, the brief that was given to me by the organizers said, and they're right in a way, that we are doing a number of sports leagues, so that perhaps is an index that this country is moving forward. But just to set the record straight, I'll mention five leagues here. The IPL makes money. But Saurav, Mr. Neutia, both of them co-own Atletico. If they lie, that's a different matter. But if they do say the truth, they are losing 20, 25 crores every year from the football club. Kabaddi,
just
losing
be careful
money.
Of him. He knows his bank account in 1938. He knows how much we lose. Thank God he didn't speak about my bank balance. So just
I don't know that. That's why I didn't say it. But seriously, every football club owner in the ISL losing money. Kabaddi, perhaps losing money. Tennis, Mahesh, seriously in debt. Wrestling league did not take off, attributed to demonetization. What is the story with Olympic sport? Is it about money, infrastructure, that we do not win, that we do not have another Abhinav Bindra with, and we still struggle with one gold medal?
I think there's several matters here, and I think it can't be addressed so easy. It's a complicated matter, but I think... For starters, cricket is a religion in our country, but we have to learn to be secular about all the other sports as well. I think it's until and unless that happens, we're not going to grow. And of course, we need investment in other sports. We need infrastructure development happening. We need a lot of grassroots development that needs to be done. And we need people to go out there and play. We need sport to become a social activity. Until and unless that happens, we aren't really growing as a sporting country. When on a weekend a family chooses to go and play sport over watching a movie, perhaps, that's when there would be some change. Until that time, your leagues will continue to lose money. And we can talk about the business of sport for 5 minutes, and that's pretty much
the
it.
End of story.
Yeah.
Deepa, you know, before sort of going into the business of sport with you and the question per se, can you just tell my audience the 1999-2000 moment when you were going in for that operation and you had a chance to speak to your husband who was at that point in time serving at the Kargil War? All of you need to hear this story first before I ask Deepa my question.
Okay. You cut me again that. Well, 1999, I was just a housewife, a graduate, educated more for matrimonial qualification. But I found my own way, and since I was in love with outdoors, I played a bit of cricket in the first women's team. And of course, it's a very overwhelming moment for me to share the same stage as Saurav Dada and, of course, legends like Abhinav. I was right behind Abhinav in the opening ceremony of the Commonwealth Games in 2010, which was a serious turn for me into sports again in at a later stage in life. And I just looked at him throughout the parade and I said, how does it feel to be an Olympian? And today I sit on the same stage next to him becoming almost an Olympian. So it's a very overwhelming moment for me. And of course, if I take you back to the time of 1999, when 10 years into marriage with two children, very small children, when husband at the Kargil War, my tumor resurfaced and the doctors said that we give you just 7 days to celebrate walking. And I was sent home to get prepared. I prepared myself for that surgery. I learned what was going to be the after effects. And to my horror, I had discovered that once the tumor will be removed, which had already eaten into the spinal cord, from that very level, which was chest below downwards, I'm going to lose all the sensation, all the power of the muscle control, and I'll be totally paralyzed for lifetime. And, well, of course, that part, I always say I was emotionally distracted because my husband was already at the war and I was not in any communication with him. And... For me, at that point of time, it was very important to live. I wasn't worried about my legs. I was only worried about getting through past that surgery alive, because it was supposed to be a brainstem surgery, and I had to be alive for my children, because I had no clue where my husband was. And sure enough, when I was taken to the surgery, the doctors asked me. So that day, two things happened, Boria. One thing was that I requested that I should walk the last steps that I to the operation theater, because I did not want to be taken on the stretcher. I just wanted to enjoy that feeling of walking, which I was going to lose when I wake up from the surgery. And second I requested was that, can I at least hear my husband, because I need to know if he's alive or not. And that is when they took me to the hotline room where the radio sets were put up, because I was in a referral and research hospital in Delhi. And from there we were made to speak in the war zone, and it was a very awkward conversation. I took on the radio set and I said, "Hello, Bikram, over," because that's what you're supposed to say, over after every line in that radio communication. So I said, "Hello, Bikram, over. They say after the tumor removal, I will never walk again. Over. I'm going to be paralyzed for my lifetime. Over." And very faintly, I heard my husband from the other end who said, "Don't worry about your legs. Over. I'm going to carry you all my life in my arms. Over. Just don't die on me." So
the point is, from there to Rio and that silver medal, you know, when we honor these people, and several people have said to Deepa, "Oh, for one medal, aapko itna paisa mil raha hai, etc., etc." I leave the jury.
He knows my bank balance too. There's something wrong with
so,
it.
But coming back to the subject, Saurav, I mean, as a cricket administrator and as a player, you have sort of been there, done that. Can you talk about how you have seen over the last couple of decades the BCCI as an organization change in terms of sports business? How cricket act, because in the 90s, the amount of money that there was and now, it's a world of difference.
Yes, absolutely. I think a lot is because of the television. The television which has come into the game. I think what cricket also does is creates heroes. And I think all sports need to do that. You know, when you open the newspapers, when you open television, it's Virat Kohli all over. And when I look on my left and when I look at my right, you know, Abhinav and Mrs. Malik, the achievements are nothing less. You know, winning an Olympic gold, an Olympic silver, a Commonwealth silver, a gold, among so many participants. You know, cricket is about 13, 14 countries playing. And when they win the gold or a silver, it's probably a bigger achievement. So I think it's important for the administrators or whoever who run the sport, whichever sport it may be, is to make the people around who's following realize that this sport is because of these two. What BCCI has done well over the years is as much as they want control, as much as they want the game to be run in their own way, but they have understood that whether it's the finance, whether it's the popularity, or whatever you call it, it's because of the players. You know, people don't come to watch a BCCI president or a CAB president or whoever it is. They come to watch a Sachin Tendulkar or a Rahul Dravid or a Virat Kohli. That's the practicality and the rule of the game. And I think as we speak about finances, as we speak about how cricket is well run, it's an example for every other sport to realize and understand that the shooting, it's Abhinav Bindra who brings people. In terms of her in Paralympics, it's about her. You know, I've seen a few biopics going around. I don't think anything can be a better biopic than hers, what she told, because I've never met her before. And this is the first time I've seen her from close and heard about her life. I've only watched her on TV carrying the national flag or competing. So it's about creating heroes and getting the kids to want to be like that. You know, once somebody asked me, why does Pakistan produce such high quality fast bowlers? I said, because the kids grew up watching Imran, Wasim, Waqar. And they asked me, why doesn't India produce high-quality fast bowlers, which is not the case these days. But in the past, because our heroes were Gavaskar, Tendulkar, and Gundappa Vishwanath, Rahul Dravid, batsman. You see the quality. You see the difference in the mindset. And I think you get young kids attracted to the sport is I want to be a Virat Kohli. I want to be an Abhinav Bindra. And it's a total consolation of all this aspect which makes the game viable, which makes the game popular. And I think the BCCI, the Board of Control of Cricket in India, has done that in a very clever way of making the players with their performances, with their visibility, the heroes with young children want to be.
Abhinav, taking off from what Saurav said, I mean, he mentioned one very important point, and that's television. Television making out, making sports people into real heroes. How do you make the sport of shooting, for example, television friendly? Because I'm aware you are on the ISSF panel. You all are grappling with these challenges. Certain sport, whether it's a shooting, whether it's an archery, whether it's any of these sports, how do you make it as television friendly so that an audience like this would watch? That's question one. And question two is, I want to actually want you to tell my audience how isolating it is. I mean, team sport is very different. But when you, in that little cocoon of yours, prepare 8-10 hours a day for 4 years, and then you know that the chances of failure are far more than chances of success. I mean, if business leaders need to take something from a sports person, if there's anything, any lesson that a sports person can actually talk about in a forum like this, what would that be?
Well, I'll answer the second part of your question because I'm not the television expert here. You are. So perhaps you could help me a little bit on how I could perhaps, what we could do to popularize my sport. But I think the sport of shooting in particular has done well in the last Olympic Games. I think the finals of the Olympic Games were very well watched. People enjoyed watching shooting on TV. It's a lot of one-to-one duels now that are happening. So it's much more attractive and people can follow it much more easily. So that's good. On the second side of it, I think as an athlete, as a sports person, you failure is part and parcel of the game. I think we fail more than we win, and that is reality. And we have to learn to we learn to take it in our stride, and we know that we will fail more than we possibly can win. So we try and focus on the process. I think it's very, very important for me was to be very process driven, to prepare in a manner and do all what I could do to prepare for the Olympic Games or to prepare for the event and be focused on the outcome and be a little bit detached from the actual outcome, right? Be process driven on the process and on preparation, but being detached from outcome. And when I went into Beijing, I was very, very detached from the outcome. I didn't care if I won gold or silver. And that perhaps showed a little bit on my reaction. I had no reaction because all what I cared about was to do my very, very best on every shot and to be completely immersed in the process of shooting rather than worrying about the outcome. And if we learn to do the process right, I think the outcome then just follows.
Deepa, I mean, it's connected. But can you tell me pre-Rio and post-Rio? If there has been enough sensitization as far as Paralympic sport is concerned, and if I can actually say that in terms of corporate funding, in terms of injection of funds, things will change or are changing? Has the 4 medals that India won made a serious dent into people's understanding?
Definitely. But honestly, this lack of sensitization actually kept us detached, like how Abhinav said just now, that we were focusing more on the process because, and we were actually detached not because we wanted to be, we were naturally detached because we knew nobody's watching. There was no farewell ceremonies, there was no mention about the Paralympics. You'll be surprised, just before Rio, people were actually asking me, para sports karte hain, hawai jahaz se parachute leke kaise kood jate hain? So that was the kind of awareness which was floating. But the medals have definitely brought in an awareness, and especially when there was the country was starved for medals this time. And we were in shortage of golds, and then Paralympic brought in golds, and then the historic first women medal happened, and it just created a fervor. And post Rio, I think we have to give a lot of credit to the media also. They immediately got on and they got us, and people noticed us. But prior to that, we've had a share of long struggle. I mean, I was just talking to Mr. Singhania, to actually fund my sports on this wheelchair, I had to be on the set of wheels they have. I had to be with JK Tires doing rallies and trying to create some kind of funding to sort of divert to my sports and eventually turn into a motivational speaker, because the corporates were ready to call me and pay me for speaking for an hour and not interested in giving me funding for my sports, in which I had to put hours and hours of my hard work and sweat. So found my own journey to the Rio, but now I guess with the latest fervor, the latest...
I'll stop you there. I mean, she says, I guess, we've got proof. How many of you have stood in queues and at ATMs since demonetization?
Oh, he loves saying that.
I love this. I mean, how many of you? How many of you, ma'am, how much time did you stand? Couple of hours, at least? At least? Several of us? If you actually were there, your time would be added, because when Deepa Malik goes to an ATM, people move away and allows her to withdraw money. That's because of her Rio recognition.
That's the power of the medal now.
that's the power of the medal now. I mean, absolutely. But Saurav, coming back to you, you know, when I see Indian cricket these days, I mean, with sport, or when you're a business leader, comes social responsibility. I mean, I see test match cricket, for example, around the world, and I see dwindling attendance. Are you concerned as an administrator and as the leader who has, you know, who wears the CAB president's hat, who knows what will happen in future, how do you deal with it? I mean, what is the business model that test cricket, for example, needs to adopt?
I think test cricket needs some changes in the format because 5 days is too long for people to sit and watch a test match, because times have changed, people have to work. The demands of jobs and demands of business has become a lot more. You see the day-night test matches in Adelaide. There were two day-night test matches played between South Africa and Australia, and the other one, I think, New Zealand versus Australia. And they had the most number of people watching. The number of people who watched in those 4 days was more than a test match which is played at the daytime. And I think that answers your question, that you want people to finish work and take their families or friends and spend a couple of hours or 3 hours watching cricket. That's how T20 is popular. That's how cinemas are popular, because you know you can watch it after work and still go home and get back ready for the next day. So that's a change which the format needs. I think in India the cricket also suffers from too much. I think it's an organizational issue. Test matches. It's a problem when administrators start believing that, you know, it doesn't matter if test matches don't have people. We've got the IPL, we'll have a T20, couple of T20s during a series, four or five one days, and we make the money. So even if test matches, there are about 5,000 people watching, how does it matter? Our coffers are full. I think that's a wrong way of looking at test matches, because test matches is a real part of cricket. It tests you. That's why it's called a test match. You know, Virat Kohli has to bat 10 hours to get a 240. There are slips, there are short leg, there are balls spinning and jumping, it's seaming. And you need a lot more skill than just hitting through the line and clearing boundaries with heavy bats. You look at England, you go to England, you see a Lord's test match. You see a Oval test match. You see a Manchester test match. And it's full house. England played Pakistan in a test match at the Oval. And every day of the test was a full house. And I would have understood if it was an Ashes series or if India was going, people come to watch a Kohli or a Tendulkar or a Dravid. So it's also about organizing. You know, I've just been an administrator for a year. And what shocked me to see that in my own association, the tickets are put up on sale 4 or 5 weeks, or rather 3 weeks before the game. And you go to England, you go to Lords, the tickets are sold out six months ago. You know, I remember wanting to watch the World Cup football final, which was in Brazil. And the final was in July, and I read it on the net that you have to get your tickets by the August of the previous year. So I had to send someone from Brazil, one of my friends, to stand in line get 4 tickets for me to watch the World Cup final. So that's how well they are prepared. Yeah. I think Indian cricket takes a lot of things for granted. Indian cricket, because of abundance, because of everybody wanting to put in money into Indian cricket, the visibility, the television factor, the names, you know, Sachin Tendulkar or whatever you call it. Sometimes we live with this that it's going to come whatever it happens. And I think that's a bit of a problem for Indian cricket.
Once again, Saurav will take a jibe at me, but the backstage story of Saurav's watching that World Cup final is that he actually got the tickets, but unfortunately did not watch the World Cup final because he was busy commentating for an England-India series and doing some work with me in England and kept blaming me because we watched the final on television together. Anyway.
It's a decision which I had to make. Does the money come in the bank or goes out of the bank? So I thought coming into the bank was a better option.
Abhinav, you know, we keep talking about infrastructure, money, corporate funding, as if there is nothing in India. Let me just sort of take the other side to my audience. Jamaica, inner city Jamaica, crime rate 20 times more than India. Finance, not there compared to India, way backward. Number of Olympic medals, Usain Bolt, Johan Blake, Nesta Carter, Michael Frater, I can keep going on and on. Two medal winners from Croatia this time were sleeping on the floor of another athlete who was a sailor. There are several such countries. We mean to say Bosnia, Croatia, Fiji, they have economic infrastructure better than India? Absolutely not. So is it only to do about money? And I'm asking you specifically this question because you were part of that NRAI committee, which for the first time I've seen a committee do work. And that NRAI committee gave a report where you said that we do have money. Our athletes weren't able to use the money properly. Can you elaborate?
Well, I think talking about Rio, I think our elite athletes had access to a lot of funding, a lot of government funding. But the money tends to come in at the very end. I mean, if you give $100,000 to an athlete 3 months before the Olympic Games, he or she's not going to be able to do anything with that money, perhaps go on a holiday with it or whatever, and that's what happened. But 3 months before the Olympic Games, you're already prepared. You can't really do anything at that stage to prepare. So preparation doesn't just happen at the very end. You know, the Olympics comes once in 4 years, but for the athlete, it's every day. The medal is not won at the Olympic Games, and the medal is actually won on what the athlete is doing in the 4 years in between. So that to me is the most important thing. So Indian athletes, of course, they need to have access to the funding, and they need to plan to have access to experts who could help them plan their careers in a scientific manner, their preparation in a scientific manner, so that they are able to build peak cycles and perform and prepare in a way where they are in the peak of their performance when it really matters. And they have to prepare. You cannot let go of science and technology in today's day and age, and we need to embrace that. And part of it is available in India, part of it is not. So the whole question of expertise, I think we do not have that expertise in India, and we need to import that expertise. But having said that, we also need to empower our own people. We need to empower our own coaches who could help our athletes, but it's a process, and that process starts the day after the closing ceremony of an Olympic Games.
You know, I completely agree with Abhinav. Every sport, the success of every sport or the business of every sport is a system. It's a system which has to be created. Why BCCI or the Board of Control for Cricket stands out above the rest is because they have an unbelievable structure to produce cricketers. And you must remember, today Abhinav Bindra, who's won an Olympic gold, or Mrs. Malik, who's won a silver, they actually are the persons who create the funds for the next generation. Today, Virat Kohli earns about 150 crores a year. It's because Sachin Tendulkar, or a Dravid, created that mass attraction of people or television to come back and fund for Virat Kohli. One Abhinav Bindra creates opportunities for the next three, and that's when administration comes in. That's when the system comes in. Sports, no sports in the world is an instant success. You know, sports is about natural flair. Sports is about, it's not just about the gyms and not just about the routines and all the books and knowledges which you need to. Sachin Tendulkar You know, I've seen him very closely, the best ever the world has produced. I haven't seen Donald Bradman, but I've never seen run around a cricket ground. In the later part of his career, when he started training, he never enjoyed running. He was the fastest in between the wickets I've seen. He used to sit on a cycle where one day I was captain of India, and he's a very dear friend of mine. I had to go and tell him that my mother cycles quicker than he does, because he sits on that bike with his music for an hour and cycles at a speed of 5 or 6. So I told him, listen, Chief, the others are watching. You're the best in the world. Just try and do something different. But that's the way it is. That's the way it is. And so it's not just about natural talent. Every now and then you'll have a Bindra or you have a Malik to take that sport forward. But to make that sport viable, to make that sport a business opportunity, Abhinav Bindra has to support in creating another Abhinav Bindra. And that's where administration comes in. Keep him in the picture. Make him your model. Make him your source of inspiration or source of income for the association, for the sport, and pass it on to the next generation. I think that's very, very important.
Saurav has actually given me the lead on that. Just so all of you know, Abhinav Bindra in Chandigarh has set up a high-performance center with ultra-modern technology. And I'm quoting Abhinav Bindra, the technology that he has there will not only put us at par with the best sporting nations of the world, but will place us ahead of the curve. Not the end of story there. He has made that center free for every high-performance athlete coming out of India. Deepa, question to you. Okay, I have exactly 6 more minutes to discuss with my speakers when and I'll open it up. So please frame your questions, address them to whoever you want to, but questions so that I can get maximum out of them in my 15 minutes of discussion time. The one thing that has dented the sport of cricket has affected you as well. That dreaded word called fixing. Over to you. Tell me the story.
Oh my God. Yes, I guess it took me 10 years to be at the Paralympics. I started at the age of 36 in 2006 as a swimmer. First 3 years were as a swimmer. And at the age of 39, I learned how to hold a javelin and a shot put. And I started training for that. 2012, I could have been at the Paralympics because I had qualified the minimum qualification standard. But due to lack of quota allocation to my nation, because when 3 people qualify in my Paralympic sport, 1 quota allocation comes to the country. In spite of sitting qualified, I could not go because there was just 1 woman and no quota for the woman to represent country. 29th August 2012, London Paralympics opening ceremony was going on and I was in the Rashtrapati Bhavan picking up my Arjun Award. And everybody was consoling, not congratulating, but consoling me saying, koi baat nahi, Paralympic nahi hua, Arjun Award to phir bhi mil gaya. 42 years mein Arjun Award mil gaya aur kya chahiye, madam, retire hoke aram kariye. But I wanted to be the Paralympian. I wanted to be at the Olympic level sport. And I continued struggling. I struggled, I trained very hard. In 2014, created a new record, the Asian record, picked up my medal in javelin, hoping to be at Rio Paralympics. And when the MQS list comes out for my disability category, it is shot put and not javelin. Now, if I have to be a Paralympian, I have to train all over again in shot put, where the equipment is far heavier than a 600-gram javelin. I'm up against 2 younger women. Luckily, 3 girls qualified this time. So I was hoping that 1 quota will come for a woman to represent India. And this time, the girls were 20 years younger in a different discipline, in a better disability than mine. Mine is much severe. And they were practicing to throw a discus, which is a kg of equipment. I was up for a heavier equipment. And at 46, people had discarded. Nobody was even talking about me and saying Deepa will ever make it, because they were only looking at the younger talent, who, incidentally, they were training in Finland Olympic Center. And finally, when the selection trials happened, which was 26th of July, the internal trials for that 1 woman's seat, We all threw. We were in different categories. We were athletes, but we were up against our own world ranking. The girl threw. She secured the 5th world ranking. And I was at 8th in the last competition, in the 8th world ranking. And when I threw my shot put, it was equivalent to current world ranking 1 in that year, 2016. So I made it to the selections. I was very happy that finally my dream after 10 years is coming true. I was able to defy all odds, odds of age, of odds of disability, odds of not going abroad and training. And suddenly, next day morning, when I opened the newspapers, excitedly thinking that it'll have my name in the front page saying the first woman ever to represent India is Deepa Malik, and she'll be going to the Paralympics. And to my horror, the news said that Deepa Malik's selection has been challenged in the High Court by the other girl, saying that she fixed it. And then began the horrendous journey of High Courts. A time when I should be seriously training, my 4.48 distance on that day was challenged in the High Court. 12th August was the last date when the entry was to go for Rio Paralympics. 11th August at 6 p.m., the court gave its verdict. Last 15 days to Rio Paralympics. I should have been training, focused, but here I was running between the High Court and the lawyers. But 11th August, 6 p.m., they declared that your name is fine and selection committee has yet again cleared. So the journey, which was the want of becoming a Paralympian, actually turned into clearing my name of that allegations that the big fish had eaten up the small fish. Deepa Malik, because she was already an Arjun Awardee and a known person and a general's daughter-in-law and a colonel's wife, has kind of rigged her way to the selections. And I was getting these weird SMSs and WhatsApps every day. In my inbox and Facebook was filled with messages saying, Dubara 4.48 phek ke to dikhana hum apna naam badal lenge. So when I was up there for the competition, it was more a struggle for honesty, because being an army officer's wife and coming from an army background, that was the biggest burden on me. My second throw was 4.49. And the white flag came up. And I was, all right, I have done it. So I guess for me at that point of time, Rio got over at 4.48. But of course, the medal I picked up was at 4.61. So
I don't think I should ask any more. Open to questions. Questions, please introduce yourself, sir. Can I have microphones there, please? Please introduce yourself and address the question to whoever. I think there's a microphone there. Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I'm Sanjay Karan. My question to the panelists is, we have seen a lot of talented guys when it comes to junior sports, hockey, cricket, everything. Somewhere down the line, by the time they get into the senior players list, they get lost. How does the country manage that talent?
Saurav?
Thank you for the question. I don't think it happens in cricket. You know, a lot of these young players, I've seen Sachin Tendulkar at the age of 13, and I've seen him till the end of his career. I've seen Rahul Dravid at the age of 14, even Virat Kohli at the age of 14. And they've gone that distance to become one of the greats in the world. And for that, the system is important. It is about the transformation of the player from a junior level to at the international level, and his success depends on what we administrators provide, what we associations provide, what we sports bodies provide. Abhinav said something very rightly, that you don't produce a champion in 3 months. That $100,000 has to come year after year after year for the next 15, 20 years to produce 5 champions in those 20-year period. And I think that's where cricket in India is different, because the investment which goes in for a Jayant Yadav is the same for a Virat Kohli, or the same which has gone in for Sachin Tendulkar and the player before. So all of us who run sports federations must realize that any game, any sport, runs because of the players. It's run because of the athletes. The athletes make that sport popular. Sometimes, and I'm an administrator now, I am the president of the Cricket Association of Bengal, and I can see it. We as administrators at times feel that, yaar, dusre aa jayenge. Ye gaya, dusra aa jayega, kya farak padta hai? Champions don't come that way. You have to respect a player. If you respect a player, because the public ultimately sees the player. If you respect the players, public will respect the players and the sport will be a success. It cannot happen other than any other system because, as I said, it is the players who create the game and not anybody else.
Great. The gentleman there and then the lady there.
I am Nilesh Shukla, President Vadodara Chamber of Commerce and Industry. I am a member body of FICCI. सर मुझे आज एक चीज बहुत अच्छी लगी कि स्पोर्ट्स को अगर आगे लाना है हम सब बात करते हैं तो यूजीसी या डीआईसीटी में स्पोर्ट्स के लिए रिलेटेड कुछ स्पेशल प्रिविलेज मिले वो भी हमें आज की मीटिंग में कुछ ऐसा करना चाहिए एंड सेकंड माय सजेशन इज बिकॉज सजेशन इसलिए है द वे ये सुनने के बाद कि सीएसआर के अंदर हम क्यों ना स्पोर्ट्स के लिए at least 5% accept cricket because cricket ko paise ki zarurat nahi hai accept cricket dusre games ko compulsory csr mein bhi allowed ki jaye and my last request to my all FICCI big tycoon ke jo sab itne bade hai at least aaj ki meeting ke baad itna morally sapat le le ki aaj ke baad koi bhi dusri sport mein bhi cricket ke siwa wo sponsor karenge
सर आपने जो बोला अभिनव को मैं वो सीएसआर वाला क्वेश्चन का आंसर उससे मांगूंगा बट आई विल टेक दैट यूजीसी क्वेश्चन विद योर परमिशन आई हैव बीन ऑन सेवरल यूजीसी कमिटीज मायसेल्फ व्हिच हैज रेकमेंडेड द इनकॉर्पोरेशन ऑफ स्पोर्ट इनटू द स्कूल एंड कॉलेज करिकुला इफ यू एक्चुअली सी द यूनाइटेड स्टेट्स एंड कैनेडा 50% ऑफ द ओलंपिक एथलीट्स कम फ्रॉम द D1 द यूनिवर्सिटी स्ट्रक्चर एंड इन इंडिया नॉट इवन वन एथलीट कम्स फ्रॉम दैट एकेडमिक स्ट्रक्चर एंड वी वर हैविंग दिस मीटिंग आप एक बात बताओ फिजिकल एजुकेशन टीचर और मैथमेटिक्स टीचर को सेम सम्मान दिया जाता है हमारे देश में सो द प्रॉब्लम इज देयर आप फिजिकल एजुकेशन टर्मिनोलॉजी को चेंज कर दो पहले एंड डज द यूजीसी हैव मनी व्हेन वी वर हैविंग लंच आई एक्चुअली वाज गिविंग द फिगर अवे इन वन ऑफ द कमिटीज आई आस्क्ड द चेयरमैन हाउ मच मनी डज यूजीसी हैव ही सेड पैसा का कोई प्रॉब्लम नहीं है कितना चाहिए तुम्हें आई सेड व्हाट डू यू मीन अपेरेंटली इन द लास्ट 5-year प्लान सेवरल थाउजेंड क्रोर्स वर नॉट स्पेंट बाय द यूजीसी दैट वाज द एक्सेस okay and 5-600 crores is no mean money for I mean nothing for the UGC which has so much money so all we need is 5 centers of excellence across the country 5 universities and we will be able to produce champions so unless there is a merger unless there is an incorporation of academia and sport and organizations like this can spearhead that challenge there will be no revolution there will be one Saurav Ganguly one Deepa Malik and one Abhinav Bindra Abhinav the CSR point
well philanthropy in India is a complicated subject but yeah I think the point I'd like to make is I look at the example of the United States the US government does not even spend $1 on their Olympic team the entire US Olympic team is funded is sponsored by the corporate world so I just like to appeal to all of you to open your hearts and minds and perhaps your pockets towards Olympic sport as well We need it. We need it badly.
The lady there. Maybe one more. Microphone there, please. Yes, sir. You'll be the last.
My question is for Saurav Ganguly. Hi, Saurav. I'm Nivedita from FICCI. You know, Boria spoke of the dwindling crowd at matches, which is a matter of concern. And there's also been talk of, you know, IPLs being attached a lot to glamour, money, and controversies. Do you really think IPL can contribute to Indian cricket in the long run? And should this format be retained, given the dent it is making on the classic, you know, paradigm of cricket?
Absolutely. And this format has to be retained and should be retained because, as I said, times have changed. Funds is very important in running the sport. Funds are very important in creating an infrastructure. You know, the pitches, the stadiums. The BCCI is the only body which has their own stadiums everywhere in India. We are 31 states who run the cricket in this country, and each of them have their own stadium. You don't need to go back to the government for funds or for using their stadiums on a rental basis. It doesn't happen like that. So IPL brings in the funds, and I don't think IPL takes away any sense of skill from any cricket. Otherwise, Virat Kohli wouldn't be successful in Test match cricket or an IPL cricket. You look at Kevin Peterson, you look at David Warner, you know, Shane Warne when he played, success in all formats of the game. I don't think one format takes away your skill. You just have to adapt. You just have to adapt. And as I said, everything is a combination, a success story, a successful athlete is a combination of everything. Boria spoke about UGC and sport binding together. That can only happen with attitude of the people who run it, the mindset of the people who run it. That is very, very important. So the answer to your question is all format will survive on its own. And to make Test cricket more popular, I think a lot more importance has to be given to that. A lot more planning has to be given to that and organizational capability. BCCI, in spite of its very immature organizational setups in various state bodies, have still managed to make this sport a successful one.
So the question there...
Can I take a minute an appeal when we talk of CSRs? I think FICCI and all of you here, the members of FICCI, have really declared today by inviting me on the same dais here as a sportswoman and honoring me and made me sit here, you have declared that yes, you all are very inclusive in nature and you all have accepted parasports as a mainstream sport and given it equal status. I extend my heartfelt gratitude for that. Thank you for this recognition. And at the same time, when we're talking of CSR, please do devote some amount to the parasports because we need it a lot. There are a lot of challenges for us and we need the CSR support as much as possible. But at the same time, I also want to make a request that do a direct adoption of athletes and please keep an accountability of their performance. Don't just give away CSR to various NGOs or organizations blindly just for the fact that you have to do a certain CSR because it's a mandate. And two, it's a tax saving, whatever. So don't give it away. If you're involving yourself, please have 100% involvement. Adopt athletes and also take account of their performance day after day. I think then we will have the real purpose of the CSR. There has to be a correct feedback on the CSR also. The money spent.
So the last question, very quickly, my time is almost up.
I'm Ravindra Arora from Film and Television Producers Association, Bombay.
Question.
Sir, Dada, aapki life ka biggest mistake, Greg Chappell. And Deepa ji se, or Dada on sports se, ki Hindustan mein hi nahi, Vishw mein, sportsmanship missing hai, kyunki humari education system mein sportsmanship rakhna sikhaya nahi jata.
Okay, that was a comment. Good. 3:45 was the time given to me. It's 3:44. So I'll close with some closing comments, just about 20 seconds each on my three guests and three speakers. You know, at Rio, Abhinav and I spent a lot of time together. And I keep doing this and he keeps laughing at me saying you glorify a fourth place finish. But just to let you know, that Abhinav lost by 0.1. Do you know what a 0.1 is like? If any of the ladies sitting in front, and I keep doing this, if you take a strand of your hair and hold it up, if anyone in this audience is able to see the strand of their hair, the tip of that strand, it's half of that. So that's the difference between a winner and a loser of an Olympic medal in sport. That's how difficult it is. So we really, really need to produce champions over 4 years and not 4 months. Deepa Malik, because I'll close with Saurav. She's been sort of going from pillar to post since coming back from Rio, getting celebrated all over the country and very rightly so. But then I asked Deepa, what next? Are you planning on retiring? She said, I've already started training for the London World Championship in July. And come Tokyo, maybe the silver will turn into gold. Finally, to Saurav Ganguly. 2003-04, India was written off by even, he speaks a lot about the BCCI as an administrator these days. At that point in time, the BCCI secretary said, India will lose 0-4 in Australia because this is a team that has no chance. Saurav Ganguly rewrites history books by scoring that 144 in Brisbane. The series turns on its head. It's a series we should have won. It was one all, and India played the best in Australia. Thereafter, we beat Pakistan in Pakistan under Saurav, and Indian cricket's revolution was complete. So on that note, ladies and gentlemen, I think three very extraordinary people. Can I have a standing ovation for Saurav Ganguly, Abhinav Bindra, and Deepa Malik? Thank you very much.